Joining us now for more on this, we have Comelec spokesperson James Jimenez. Good morning, Director James.
Good morning, Mike.
Yesterday was quite a busy day for you. Tell us what happened yesterday. We woke up to news saying that first Attorney Te was saying that they have yet to receive a verified answer from the camp of presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos. And then Attorney Vic Rodriguez on national TV at 9 in the morning said, oh, we have actually been granted an extension. Right. And then at 1:30 p.m. you said, there's no such thing yet, only to confirm it later later that afternoon, about 3 o'clock. So what happened? Tell us what happened yesterday.
Well, it happened exactly as you said. In the morning, there was news that Attorney Te came out with that statement regarding the lack of a verified answer. And then I was told that Attorney Rodriguez had been saying that that he had received an extension. So I verified that claim and found out that it was not true, at least at that moment. I spoke to several people who would know, who would be authoritative in this matter. And they all assured me that no such extension had been granted. And in fact, it had not been granted until around 2:50 in the afternoon, after I gave my announcement, after I had argued about it extensively online, right? So whether or not the lawyers for Senator Marcos actually had a piece of paper saying that there was an extension at the time that they said it, I sincerely doubt it, because that official announcement came out in the afternoon after I had said that there was no such thing.
But would you be able to tell us, Director James, when the actual meeting of the second division of Comelec actually took place? When did they decide to grant that extension? Was it only yesterday? Was it the day before?
To my knowledge, it was only yesterday. To my knowledge, it was only yesterday at around midday.
Midday. But yeah, we already have spokesperson for Marcos, Attorney Vic Rodriguez, announcing it on nationwide TV at past 9 in the morning.
Well, as I said yesterday, a lot of this is about conditioning the mind of the public. A lot of this is about propaganda. A lot of this is about sending the signal that, you know, we're doing fine and we're going to win this case. And that's a common enough legal strategy.
Mm-hmm. And the question really, Director James, in the minds of many is, how could have Attorney Vic Rodriguez known about it earlier? And we did try to ask him to come on the show. We did not receive any response, but he did answer the question yesterday to some media reporters and said, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with knowing first? Not just the media. It's not just the media who can know the information first, but really the question is, at that point, at 9 in the morning, was there information available already for anyone to find out about it?
Well, as I said, I did try to find out at around that time, and I found out the answer. And the answer was that nothing had been issued. There had been no promulgation of any extension. So as I said, I go back to what I always, to what I said about this previously. I think that he was talking out of his hat. You know, he was saying something, basically anticipating the decision of the Comelec and perhaps stating it as fact.
Mm-hmm. There is the concern here, Director James, of how they could have found out, because there are, of course, these are conjectures, but the idea of them being able to talk to Comelec commissioners, do you intend to address this? Because that's foremost in the minds of most who have been following this development.
Well, not really, unless he's shown to have actually had a piece of paper saying that that the extension was granted long before it was actually granted. Again, as I said, anyone can say anything, right? Anyone can make any claim. I can make a claim now that that the decision will go badly for this party, or that it will go badly for that party. And if it turns out that my guess was right, I'll look omniscient or I'll look prescient, right? But that doesn't necessarily mean I have any advance information. Sometimes it's all about the confidence with which you say it. And I think that's what happened in this case. I think in this case, this particular lawyer felt strongly enough that they were going to get it and made an announcement along those lines. Doesn't necessarily mean that he had any inside information.
But what about Director James, the eventuality that eventually, actually, he was right all along? So that was just a guess?
Well, it's always 50-50, right? I mean, it's always a 50-50 chance. Again, right now, I think one of the things that I've been hearing is that a protest or an appeal will be filed against the extension. I think that would be the opportunity for all the parties involved to find out if, in fact, Attorney Vic Rodriguez was speaking from personal knowledge or whether or not he was simply being the lawyer that he is.
But let's talk about the deliberations of the commissioners in this case. Because in the Supreme Court, for example, if it's the Supreme Court unbanked meeting, then they are really bound by confidentiality. They're not even supposed to disclose it even to their staff. So if information leaks from the Supreme Court, most likely it came from the Supreme Court justice. In this case, in the case of Comelec commissioners, is that a similar situation? Are they bound by any confidentiality rules, or is it possible that their staff could have known about any potential outcome of a meeting?
I don't think that having confidentiality rules per se is necessary. I think it is simply ethical if you're running a judicial or a quasi-judicial authority that you, of course, not leak your decisions ahead of time. I think that's simply ethical. Whether or not staff had access to this information, that's a different story. Our government agencies are varying levels of porosity. I mean, you know, some are more porous than others. As far as the Comelec is concerned, I don't think that we have such a major problem with that, since this is happening only in this particular case. But again, as I said, until I see proof otherwise, to me the simplest answer would be that he called it correctly.
And people would be wondering, if I were a lawyer with a license to lose, why would I make a claim if I had no basis?
Well, maybe he felt confident enough to know that the decision would come out very early, or that it would come out in their favor. Again, Mike, unfortunately, we do not have any proof that he was speaking, you know, beyond that level of confidence, that he had anything in his hands to prove that he was telling the truth. I'm not saying that he's lying, but I'm saying that he might have been very confident enough to call it ahead of time. And as you pointed out, when he was asked for proof, his answer was, well, fairly evasive, wasn't it? Saying that, you know, what's wrong with me knowing ahead of time? It's not an answer, right? This is not a reply to the question, how did you know, right? So, again, at this point, I don't see that there's too much to be made of this, especially since this is not the first time a motion for extension has been granted. Right? I mean, this happens in this case.
I'll get to that in a bit, but Director James, just on the procedure, when parties to the case, for example, are notified, especially now we are in the pandemic, so most of the notifications are by email, is there a rule that all of them should be notified at the same time? Meaning, if Attorney Tete announced on Twitter that he received the email with the resolution of Comelec granting the extension to file the verified answer, if he received it at 2:53 p.m., then the Marcos Cap, is it reasonable to conclude that the Marcos Cap should have received it at the same time?
There is no hard and fast rule that I'm aware of that says basically, you know, notice should be given simultaneously. But it's a matter of good practice that when you inform one side, you inform the other. So yes, I think it is a reasonable assumption to say that if one side received it at a particular time, then the other side received it at roughly the same time.
Now, to that point, you said that Comelec has granted extensions in the past. Is that really the case, though? Because your summons and your own rules say it's inextendable, the period for filing.
It's a procedural rule, Mike. It's a procedural rule. It's a procedural rule that's intended to facilitate the resolution of cases, right? So, it's directory. It's a rule that ultimately is left up to the discretion of the commission, I think, to be strict about or to be lenient about, considering considering the circumstances, the particular circumstances of any particular case.
Mm-hmm. Because of course, Attorney Ted, the lawyer for the one set of complainants or petitioners, is actually saying this is mandatory based on Supreme Court jurisprudence and based on the own rules of Comelec. What do you make of that?
That would be an argument that they can raise, and mm-hmm. the commission will, in its deliberations, will I'm sure take that into consideration, and then we'll talk about what the commission decides to do at that point. But mm-hmm. right now, again, if it's brought before the commission, then the commission will have to make that decision. And in this case, apparently it did.
Mm-hmm. Can you cite, Director James, if you can, previous cases where motions for extension of filing a verified answer in this particular case, cancellation of COC, has been granted?
I really can't, considering the number mm-hmm. of these cases that have gone through the Comelec's doors, mm-hmm. considering the number instances that this might have happened in the past. I really don't have that number.
But from your recollection, could you cite any particular number, like maybe three times?
I can't.
Yeah, just wanted to make sure that there are cases, really.
I'm pretty sure that there have been instances when motions for extension have been granted. I'm pretty sure that there have been instances when the Comelec has granted motions to admit late filings. That's happened. I mean, it happens. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not mistaken, in the sense of late filings, I think this even happens for filing of statements of contributions and expenditures. So mm-hmm. Again, these are procedural rules that the Comelec, of course, to my mind and to my understanding, would have the authority to say, you know, we're strict or we're not, depending on the circumstances obtaining at the time.
Mm-hmm. Now, Director James, I'm not sure if you can comment on the merits of granting that plea for an extension of time to file. But if I can just quote resolution, the resolution is saying that there was a justification found in the motion for extension, and there was also a pending petition in intervention for which the division has yet to decide whether to allow that motion to intervene in the first place. But what has happened to this motion for intervention? Because if the second division is saying we need to give time for Mr. Marcos to answer because we still have to resolve this, has that motion to intervene been resolved? And is Marcos therefore asked to also reply to that petition intervention?
The petition intervention has not been resolved yet. Mm-hmm. So what I believe he is supposed to respond to right now is the original petition for cancellation, SPA 21156.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the question, Director James, is why would this be cited as a reason for granting the extension when that can proceed separately from this particular case? If, for example, Marcos has filed this verified answer for this first petition, can he not file a supplemental answer addressing the allegations in the petition and intervention? So I'm just curious why this particular reasoning was cited in this resolution granting the extension.
Well, he could do what you said, or he could do something else, right? He could, the commission could probably be thinking that if the petition intervention were to be resolved sooner rather than later, then perhaps that could inform the answer being given. Again, I cannot speculate as to why this decision was written the way it was, but it seems to me that there is more than one interpretation possible, rather than the one you're positing. You're saying that. Wouldn't it be possible for him to file two separate? Well, yes, of course it would be. He could file five separate answers if he wanted to. Whether or not that would have any legal effect, that's a different story. He can, or the commission could be thinking that it would be more efficient, perhaps, if a petition for intervention were to be resolved and ask for his comment as well. Again, cannot speculate on how and why it was written the way it was written, but there are more interpretations than one.
Right. The next reason, Attorney James, actually, the resolution did not cite any particular justification. It just said it found justification to grant the motion for extension. Is this normal aren't resolutions supposed to cite the very reason, the very justification that was being granted?
Again, that is one way of doing it. I'm sure that this is a matter of writing style, and to me it reads like whoever wrote this decision to extend basically saw the justifications being propounded in the petition for extension and said that yeah, these are justifications, and felt no need to go beyond that assertion.
There's nothing in the rules that requires, for example, the reasons for granting a particular motion to be stated in the rules. Because, for example, if we were to compare this with the rules of court, with the usual court procedure, the judge would be required to state the reason for granting a particular motion, for example. Nothing in the rules of Comelec?
Not that I can recall offhand, no.
Mm-hmm. Let me talk about the other cases that Bongbong Marcos is facing. So you have three cancellation of certificate of candidacy cases. So yes. Does that include already the motion for motion to intervene?
This does not include the motion to intervene, since the motion to intervene has not yet been granted.
Mm, okay, so aside from the cases filed by Attorney Te on behalf of civic leaders, what are those two other cases for the cancellation of COCs of Mr. Marcos?
We have the one from Buenafet Al versus Marcos. That's for
Castle. That's the case of Attorney Te.
Yeah, Attorney Te. We have Tiburcio Marcos versus Ferdinand Marcos.
Tiburcio Marcos. This is for cancellation of COC.
Yes, for cancellation of COC. And Danilo Lihay-Lihay versus Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
And Tiburcio Marcos, for the benefit of our audience, is running for president, right?
Is running for president as well, yes.
All right. So, and Lihay-Lihay is also for cancellation of the COC. What about the declaration of Mr. Marcos as a nuisance candidate? Who filed that petition?
That would be the Lihay-Lihay petition.
Oh, okay. So what was the third cancellation of COC petition?
They're seeking cancellation of the COC on the ground that he is a nuisance candidate.
Okay. So how many cases in all, Director James? Because I thought the count was five. You have three cancellation of COCs, one declaration of nuisance, the other one disqualification. No, the one filed by Attorney Calera.
The number five comes from the number of cases that are pending with us right now, because it includes a case against someone, not Marcos.
Okay. So in total, how many cases against
Marcos? Four.
Four. All right. All right. Now, there's a question here, Director James, about the last petition that was filed, because somehow it both asked for the cancellation of the COC at the same time for the disqualification of Mr. Marcos. Under the rules of the Comelec, is that a ground for summary dismissal? Some have pointed out.
I'll have to check. Again, this is not something that's been made that I've been made aware of. That there is a specific ground saying that it would result in summary dismissal.
Mm-hmm. So what will happen now to these cases? When you say that they are now counted, that means they've been given due course. Is that right?
Yes.
And when are we expecting the next incidents to happen? Aside from the November 26, is that the preliminary conference for the first case?
The preliminary conference for the case of Buenafe et al. Versus Marcos is set for the 26th. The others have yet to be scheduled.
Mm-hmm. And it will not be affected by the extension given to Mr. Marcos to file his...
The extension is fairly specific. It's for that particular case.
So the only pending motion is the motion for intervention. Has it been wrapped? Will it also go to the second division?
Which one? The
intervention? The motion to intervene. Petition and intervention.
I think logically it would, yes.
Mm-hmm. How about the other cases? Have they been raffled to other divisions or to any division?
Not that I know of yet.
Oh, no action yet. All right. So on that note, Director James, thank you so much for the clarifications this morning. And thank you for answering our questions.
Thank you.